Hello everyone, welcome to Byju's exam prep. I'm Savitri Krishnamurti, your VARC mentor at Byju's. Why am I here today? Because it's Thursday and it is VA Thursday. And what have I got for you? I have got for you IIFT RC rules. What does that mean? RC is one section which is misused, underused and abused in IIFT because you don't give enough attention to reading comprehension in IIFT. Right? I'm not saying you have to do all the RC passages in IIFT. So today we're going to talk about how many passages should I attempt and how should I attempt the RC passages in IIFT. All right. Now, if you have seen, you know, if you're attending this session, obviously, you know, you're interested in IIFT as an exam and you know what the VARC section in IIFT is. IIFT as an exam is 2 hours long, 300 marks, 110 questions for 120 minutes. In those 110 questions, you have 35 in VARC, 30 in LRDI, 25 in Quant, and 20 in General Awareness. All right. So ideally, 2 hours means you should be spending 30 minutes each in each of the sections. But you know that these sections are more difficult. They have more marks, 3 positive, -1 if you make a mistake. Here it is only 1.5 and -0.5. And these 20 questions you can finish very quickly. Either you know the answer or you don't, right? So you should take a maximum of 8 minutes for your GK session, which means the time that you have for other sections is more. Again, because of the nature of LRDI, students find that they spend around 40-45 minutes in LRDI. That means the ideal time you'll be giving for VARC should be anywhere from 25 to 30 minutes. Obviously, there is no sectional time limit. And whenever there is no sectional time limit, that means you can finish whatever section at whatever time. Unlike CAT, where you have to do one section for a given period of time, which is a good thing and a bad thing. The good thing about it is the examiner decides how much time you require to answer a particular section. But if you finished beforehand, you cannot devote time to other sections. But if there is no sectional time limit, you tend to underestimate a particular section. And I often am afraid, as a VARC mentor, that students may not give the kind of time and attention required to VARC. Having said that, the ideal time, I feel, is 25 minutes. Okay? Now, when I say 25 minutes, in an exam, that translates to around 30 minutes. So now, if you have 30 minutes, how should your time distribution be? There are 4 RC passages, 16 questions each. All right. The rest, that means out of 35 questions, my maths is not very good, but even I can calculate 19 questions. Now, in those 19 questions, there are 3 para jumbles. So out of that, the 16 questions that you have, vocabulary and grammar. Now, in that vocabulary, again, in those 16 questions, 10 you can finish in half the time, okay, in no time at all. Which 10? Synonyms, root words, either you know it or you don't, right? One word substitutions, and in these table of words, there is a match the synonyms. You can finish them very fast because you're given a column and you just have to match the words. Crosswords, some students take time, but I'll tell you, if you practice in the last 2 years question papers and if you have taken Byju's mock tests of IIFT, you will know that the crossword doesn't have cryptic clues like the ones that you find in a newspaper. They're pretty easy. The meaning of the word is given. You just have to decide what word do we want given the number of letters in that word. Okay, so very easy it is once you work out a couple of crosswords. So what I'm trying to tell you is grammar and vocabulary would be 16 questions, which will not take you more than 10 minutes. Okay, so you've got more than 15 minutes, 15 to 20 minutes for the parajumbles and RC sections. Then what should you do for the RC? Once your verbal ability is done, you don't even have to follow that pattern that you will answer all verbal ability questions first. You can do it. In between, you can always take a breather and do an RC. But the key here is don't try to, you can, if you're good at RC, do 3 out of the 4 passages. All 4 you need not do, you cannot do probably. But you should be targeting at least 2 and if possible 3 once your verbal ability is done within the 25-30 minutes given to you. Am I clear? All right. So now let's start. How do you decide if an RC passage, most of the RC question, out of 16 last year there were 10 to 12 direct questions, fact-based questions, which you can answer immediately. All you have to do is what you did from school, what you've been doing from school. Look at the passage and say, huh, here it has been written and give it. In fact, some of the passages, if you read it properly, the one time if you read it properly, this is what I would advise my students every time, that don't go to the questions first, even if it's direct questions. Because I personally find scrolling down the passage being a waste of time. So I say, okay, when I'm scrolling down the passage, I might as well skim it. So that skimming will help you look for the correct answer instead of just doing like this, right? So you skim a passage, less than 15 seconds, 20 seconds, maximum 30 seconds, you read the first paragraph, all right? When you read the first paragraph, you say, oh, this looks like a fact-based passage, science, economics, doesn't have too much philosophy, doesn't have too much theory, language looks good, the questions are likely to be direct, let me attempt it as well. That's the first thing. Judging if you want to do the passage or not is the first thing that you need to do. All right? All right. I will give you 30 seconds or 20 seconds. Decide if this passage is worth doing. We're going to do it anyway, but decide if this passage is worth solving. Do you think it reads easy, worth doing? All right, if this is the first thing that you see in the VARC section in IIFT, you probably would quickly go down and say, okay, let me look at what is question 5. If question 5 also turns out to be a passage, then you decide between this and that, but not go back to this passage. But today I have only selected passages, so let's just move on, okay? Or should I? I'll read it aloud for you. The Reverend Jim Jones was the founder and leader of People's Temple. In 1978, Jones faced charges of tax evasion, moved most of his 1,000 followers from San Francisco to Guyana, which he named Jonestown. He faced a federal investigation for acts of child abuse and torture. So what did he do? Tax evasion in San Francisco. Other charges, child abuse and torture. So what did he decide to do? We'll poison ourselves, poison our children. So he decided to do that. All his followers prepared vats of poison and nobody resisted. Everybody agreed, and those who resisted were silenced. What happened after that? Pretty gory stuff, I suppose. Following Jones's order and social pressures imposed by one another, mothers and fathers duly poisoned their children. Then they poisoned themselves. Their bodies were found arm in arm lying together. Econs is the short form of economists. From here, so the passage starts with a gory anecdote of an entire community which poisoned themselves and their children. Okay, now when you read it, you say, okay, when any instance is given, you quickly read through it. The whole point of the passage starts from here. Econs and some economists we know are pretty unsociable creatures. They communicate with others if they can gain something from the encounter. They care about their reputations. They will learn from others if actual information can be obtained. But they are not followers of fashion. They do not do what everybody does. That's what he's saying. But humans, on the other hand, are frequently nudged by other humans. Sometimes massive social changes in markets and politics aside start with a small social nudge. Now when you've read this, you'd say anecdote, not important, you just keep reading. What does he say? This is the most important part of the of this paragraph. That's all you need to only remember, because if you want, you can always cross-check later. Most questions that you get would be direct. Human beings are nudged by others and they start with a small social nudge. That's it. Next para. Humans are not exactly lemmings. Do you know what are lemmings? Lemmings are small rats, rodents that live in the Arctic area. Now, why did he bring in this? It's an interesting observation. One thing about lemmings, if you just Google, one of the things that they'll tell you about lemmings is that these rats are known to move in herds. They move in big numbers. And humans have observed a strange behavior. They all jump off cliffs suddenly. So that's why he's brought in this. Even if you didn't know what are lemmings, it doesn't matter. This is not important for me to understand. It's just interesting. They are influenced by statements and deeds of others. From this, you can say that lemmings are influenced by statements and deeds of others. Okay? And then he says, if you see a movie in which people are smiling, you are most likely to smile yourself. So you follow others. What others do, you do that. That's what he's saying. You copy, you are influenced by the words and deeds of others. Second most important part of the point, of the paragraph. Now remember, you have read this, you're going to read this in the exam in 30 seconds, 45 seconds. Maximum each slide that I'm showing you, you won't be spending more than 40 seconds. Conventional wisdom has that if two people live together for a long time, they start to look like each other. Really? This because folk wisdom turns out to be true. How is it true? They don't exactly look alike. Suddenly Deepika Padukone won't start looking like Ranveer Singh or the other way around. No. What happens is that you have shared diets and eating habits, and because of that you imitate each other, you grow like each other, and you have similar facial expressions. It's not like suddenly your face changes structure, but your expressions are similar and therefore you start looking similar to each other. Not important. Basic thing he says is we are alike, we influence each other. That's the main point here. Here we are trying to understand how and why social influences work. And understanding of those influences is important in our context for two reasons. Why do we need to understand how social influences work? Because most people learn from others. Learning from others is how individuals and societies develop. You learn from others, and the good part about learning from others is that's how you develop as an individual, that's how the society develops. But many of our biggest misconceptions, our wrong ideas, also come from others. When social influences have caused people to look to have false and biased beliefs, then some nudging may help. False news, fake news, you start having wrong ideas, then a little nudge in the right direction, a little influence in the right direction helps. Okay, so number one. Second reason why this topic is important, so see how beautifully the author is drawing you towards the main point of the passage. You don't have to search for it. The second reason is that one of the most effective ways to nudge is through social influence. One, that we learn to influence each other, that's how you develop yourself, that's how societies grow. And the important way in which you nudge people in the right direction is through social influence. In Johnstown, that influence was so strong that an entire population committed suicide. But social influences have also created miracles. They've also had lots of good effects. And then he again gives you examples of people walking their dogs and carrying, cleaning up after the dog. Okay, but that's again not important. You just read. You don't skip anything. This has happened even, okay, all right. So social influences come in two basic categories. What are the two ways in which social influence works? What kind of social influence are we talking about? What categories of social influences are we talking about? First is information. you get information. Social influence works by information. If many people do something or think something, their actions and their thoughts convey information of what might be best for you to do or think. So that's how it works. The second involves peer pressure. You do something because others are doing it. And you want to go with the crowd. You want to go with, that's called herd mentality. You want to go with the herd. You want to go with the crowd. Why? Because you don't want, you want to avoid their wrath or curry their favor. You want them to be favorable towards you. You don't want to upset them or irritate them. One, information. What do they believe in? What do they think? I also will think like that. Second is peer pressure. Others are doing like this. I better do it. Otherwise, I will be the outcast. Right? So this is the two ways. And then he gives examples of how social nudges work. Teenage girls who've seen other teenage girls having children would think, okay, teenage pregnancy is fine. Obesity is contagious. He says if your roommate or your partner is fat or your friends are fat, you also tend to eat. Third, he says that broadcasters mimic each other. So you have the same kind of shows. If a reality show like Indian Idol works, then everybody makes another music show, reality show. Okay? So he says broadcasting also works. Academic effort of college students is influenced by their peers. So he says so much so that in your dorm, your roommate's influence is there on you. Who you live, share your room with, your academics, the pressure, what do they do, how are they doing? If that guy studies well, studies a lot, you end up doing that, influencing each other. So he says, the roommates can have big consequences for your grades. If he is the party kind, you're going to be the party kind, or the other way around, right? And then an important example he has given. Federal judges, when they are in 3-judge panels, are affected by the voting of their colleagues. Now, in the US, judges are appointed, right? So you have a Republican nominee, Democratic nominee. And the Republicans typically are conservative and the Democrats are supposed to be liberal. He says a typical Republican appointee shows liberal voting patterns and a Democrat shows conservative voting patterns. So you are a panel of 3, you can't have equal representation. So you'll have either 2 Republicans and 1 Democrat or 2 Democrats and 1 Republican. So if you have 2 Democrats and 1 Republican, the Republican will move towards the Democrat side and vice versa. Therefore, the bottom line is that humans are easily nudged by other human beings. You are influenced. The word nudge is used here as a synonym of influence. Why? Because we like to conform what others are doing. Let me also belong. Let me also follow. Easy passage. So when you read the first paragraph, Johnstown, Jones, federal charges, anecdote leads to something important. The second paragraph tells you it was a moderate, it read easy to moderate. Now let's look at the questions. Most of the questions you can answer without going back to the passage. Alright, first one, identify the correct statement. Good question. If he says all of the following statements are correct except, you take longer. That means out of these 4 options, 3 are wrong. Only 1 is correct. If you can identify that, half of your problems are done. Inaccurate nudging occurs as a result of information. Author talks of nudging, acting according to some information. It can influence you positively or negatively. Has he talked anything about accurate and inaccurate nudging? So this word here, we have not even come across it, right? So could this be right? Alright, second one. Successful nudging occurs as a result of the desire to avoid the disapproval of others. He says, why? Why does nudge work? Because human beings want to confirm. So this is likely to be correct. Okay, nudging is pluralistic ignorance that leads to peer pressure. Is it ignorance? Collective behavior prevents individuals from getting fined for inappropriate actions. Did he say that? Therefore, we immediately say 2 is. You don't have to look at 3 and 4 because it's a class I'm looking at 3 and 4. Once you're sure that I've got my answer, you don't have to look elsewhere. You're kind of sure, you say move on. Second one. So answer is B. Next one, again, identify the correct statement. All right, one correct, all others are wrong. So my chances of getting the answer correct are higher now. Obesity is sporadic. Did he talk about the frequency or regularity, sporadic or cyclical or what? What did he say about obesity? He said something. If your friends are fat, you will also tend to put on weight, because the word he used with obesity is not sporadic or not. What's the word he used with obesity? Contagious. It kind of catches on. Okay, so one is not correct. Learning from others is good because it helps in the development of individuals and society. Yes, this was given in the first paragraph. Right, he said people learn from others. That's a tendency of human beings. And learning from others is good because that's how you develop yourself and you develop society. So we already have our answer. Similar looking couples seldom ape each other's faces. Seldom means rarely. Author has not said that. He said you often. He said couples start looking like each other once they spend time with each other. Married couples, especially when you're there spending all your life with each other, you look alike. But he says it's not so much of you looking alike as copying each other's expressions. So you ape each other's expression. Then the word seldom should not be used there. That one word makes this option wrong. Obesity may often be the result of information provided by peers. No. Obesity, you're seeing somebody putting on weight. So where is this information that your peer gives you? So this has also not been mentioned. Okay, I am eliminating the options, but you don't have to. Once you know B is correct, move on. It's all a question of time, right? You have to be sure of your answer. Given below are four statements, okay? In the light of the above statements, choose the most appropriate answer. Now here, this is last year's paper that I'm doing with you. Our students, I did an analysis immediately after the exam, and the students were asking how is this the correct answer? How is this the correct answer is, you have to look at the answer options properly. 3 and 4 are correct. 3 and 4 are incorrect. So you have to decide between 1 and 2 are correct or 1 and 3 are incorrect. Let's quickly look at it. Republican appointees are conservative, true or not? Yes. Because he says when Republican appointees start working with Democratic appointees, they start voting on a more liberal pattern. That means by nature they are conservative. So this is correct. Democratic appointees are generally liberal. This is also correct. 1 and 2 are correct has not been given. Here it is given 1 and 3 are correct. So we cannot say it is D. Okay. Then let's look at 3. Three judge panels are known for inaccurate decisions. This is not what the author said. What did he say? He said three judge panels are known for the way the voting patterns happen, not for inaccurate decisions. So three is incorrect according to what's given in the passage. Dormitory students are better performers in college. No. Dorm students perform. Their performance is influenced by their roommates. Doesn't mean they perform better or otherwise. It's influence. Therefore, 3 and 4 are incorrect is the correct option. So what's the answer we want? B. Alright, understood? Okay, let's look at the last question. What is the main idea of the passage? You don't even have to ever, the entire passage, because we read it properly once, we don't have to go back to the passage. If you have a doubt, go back, but make sure you don't do this. Spend most time searching for the right answer. You read it once, then you know which information is given where. It's a good idea. I would always follow the school of thought. Even if your questions are direct, read the passage once quickly and thoroughly. In many cases, you don't have to go back to the passage. You know the main point. What's the main point of the idea of the passage? Is it causes and preventions of mass suicide? Yes, the passage starts with an anecdote about suicide. But that's not the main point. The point was to tell how an entire group got influenced to work and do something hideous and terrible, right? So it's not causes and prevention of mass suicide. Mindset problems of some economists. No, he gave an example that look, they have this mindset that they'll only talk to you if they can get information from you. That's not the main point. That's just one of the points he mentions. The contagious nature of human emotion. Obesity seems to be contagious, not contagious nature. Influence is not the same as contagious. Behavior is the result of following the herd, the group. Yes, that's the answer we want. So our answer is 4. D. Right? So this was a passage, when you read the first paragraph, didn't look that easy, but it turned out to be easy. Now, we are exactly in the situation that you'd find yourself in an IIFT exam. I've got 5 minutes, I've got 10 minutes. Do I do the next passage or not? I've got 2 passages left. I'm going to show you the next passage for 20 seconds. Okay, it's okay. Yeah, I'll show it to you for 20 seconds. Read it on your own. What is the impression you get when you read this passage? You want to do this passage or no? Little tough it looks like, okay? Question, according to Mr. Mocker's thesis, direct. Mr. Enrico Spoller believes, direct. He tries to analyze, well, maybe inferential. Theme of the passage, direct. I might do this. Now look at the next one. Again, I'll give you 15 seconds. Let's read it together. Okay? Read for 10-15 seconds. As Western holidaymakers escape their daily grind and head to the beach this summer, a concern is likely to resurface. Literally, really. If it washes up on the pristine sand in front of them. So you will be hit by a worry. What is that? In the past 2 years, if it washes up, if a piece of pollutant comes and hits you, literally, then that is the concern. What is the concern? He is explaining. In the past 2 years, plastic litter in the ocean seems to have eclipsed. Plastic litter in the ocean, that's the concern. Seems to have eclipsed other environmental anxieties among rich world consumers. In the last 2 years, our main worry has been plastic litter, garbage in the ocean. And you see harrowing, terrible images of sea life ensnared in plastic bags, as depicted in Blue Planet 2, a popular British television series from 2019 presented by Sir David Attenborough, which would be enough to make anyone choke on the plastic straw in the piña colada if that is what you were if you were offered one. Nobody is offering plastic straws. If you were having your drink with a plastic straw, you would choke on it. That's what he says. Again, I'm not going to read that again. Next one. Politicians everywhere are responding to voters' demands by banning straws, stirrers, and other single-use plastics. Then, an example of what are politicians and governments around the world doing. The UN says that last year, 127 countries had restrictions on plastic bags. This month, Panama became the first Central American country to outlaw them. Britain is considering a tax on plastic packaging material made with less than 30% recycled content. In March, 560 members of the European Parliament backed a law that would require 90% of the plastic bottles to be recycled. So politicians are banning single-use plastic. Politicians are, countries and governments all over the world are encouraging recycling. All right. Next. Given the environmental footprint of substitutes like cotton bags, aluminium cans, paper boxes, which often require more energy to make and transport them, plastic equivalents, new regulations could in fact end up doing harm to the planet. What's he saying? He is saying that given the environmental footprints, if you take into account the environmental footprints of plastic substitutes, there is more energy, more water, more everything required to make them than to make a plastic equivalent or plastic. So the author seems to be saying something different here, right? He is saying plastic substitutes, the carbon footprint of those seems to be greater than of plastic. This point, if you remember, the entire passage is there for yours for the taking. Nonetheless, the plastic industry can expect more curbs, a trend that will force businesses involved to reshape. He says many companies in the 375 billion plastic packaging value chain. So all these companies which form the plastic packaging value chain, what is that value chain? Oil and gas, producers of oil and gas, petrochemical giants, packaging firms and consumer brands. This is the plastic packaging value chain. He says they look ill prepared, they're not well prepared to meet this challenge. Consumers, companies at either end of the chain, that means oil producers and the consumer brands, are the least vulnerable. Okay, and then he tells you that they are going to face, definitely going to face some sort of a reduction in their profit margins, but they are going to be the least vulnerable. Who is going to suffer most? Plastic packaging firms could suffer more. Why? And he gives you the reason why. Then he says there is the petrochemical industry. They are also going to suffer. And how are they going to suffer? Alright, let's look at the questions. I did not read the third and the fourth paragraph, right? Because I'm running out of time, you're running out of time. Just like you're running out of time in the exam. Just let's look at the questions. According to the author, the plastic related concerns in rich countries. Remember in the first paragraph, he said in the past 2 years, the plastic related concerns of the rich world consumers, plastic litter has eclipsed other environmental anxieties. And that is what the question is asking us. Plastic related concerns in rich countries have done what? Overshadowed other environmental concerns, eclipsed other environmental concerns, same thing. So now you know the answer is A. Why do I need to look back? Got it? Okay, next one. The correct sequence in the plastic packaging value chain. We did that. I showed it to you. Correct sequence in the plastic packaging value chain. Producers of oil and gas. Producers of oil and gas. Next, petrochemical giants. Next, packaging firms. And next is the consumer brands. So look at the option which gives us that. Oil companies, petrochemical giants, packaging companies, consumer product companies. Would 10 be a good answer for that? Yes, we don't have to look further. All right, we only know oil and gas producers, so oil companies. That comes first. Here also it comes, here also it comes. But here consumers comes before packaging. He talks of packaging before consumers. So between 1 and 3, 1 is correct, you'll mark A. All right. The political response to people's environmental concerns. Remember, how is the ban going to affect the four people in the value chain is given in the third and fourth paragraph. We haven't read that. If there is a question on that and if I have the time, I'm going to look at those answers. But now I'm not going to look at it. So what has the political response been? Remember, we highlighted it. The political response has been to ban, right? Ban all single-use plastics and encourage recycling. All these companies have said start recycling. So what are most politicians doing? How have they responded? Question 11, political is not banning this. Promoting single-use, no. Banning single-use, so answer is encourage recycling. Ban single use, here it's even promote single use, so one is wrong, so the answer is B. Easy so far? Good. Okay, next one. The new regulations on plastic packaging could end up doing more harm. Remember the part where he said, given the carbon footprints of the plastic substitutes like cotton cloth bags and all, they could end up doing more. Why is the carbon footprint what is the carbon footprint of these plastic substitutes going to be? If they use more energy, more water to make and transport, their carbon footprint will be more. That's what he is saying. So answer will be environmental footprints of substitutes is higher. He's saying if you take into consideration the plastic footprints of plastic substitutes, it is way more than plastic equivalents. Why? Because they use more energy and more water. So what is the answer? C. So what did it tell you about the RC passages in IIFT? They are easy. Some are easier than others. Looking at the genre of the passage, looking at the questions, you can answer at least two, if not three. I would love it if you could do three. You can actually, if you manage your time well, you can do even three passages. The way we did the last passage. Don't read the last two paragraphs. We got most of it from the first two. We got the main point. Then we start looking at the questions. If the answer is not there, we'll go to the last paragraph. Otherwise, we're not going to do the question. You don't have to answer all the RC passages, but don't leave the entire RC section. Rule number one. Rule number two, when you do those RC passages, read it once quickly and thoroughly so that in many questions like the main theme and main point, you don't have to go back to the passage. In fact, except the plastic value chain here, you didn't have to go back. I didn't show you plastic value chain because I underlined it while reading for you to remember, right? And when you are doing an RC passage, 3 out of 4 questions also, if you can do within the 5 minutes that you have before you move on to the next session, would make it a huge increment to your overall score. I hope you enjoyed the session. I enjoyed taking it for you. And I wanted to drive home the point that RCs in IIFT are easy. That does not mean you'll do all the RCs. RCs are long, that does not mean you skip RCs. So maintain a balance. After your verbal ability questions are done, there would be a couple that you will not know, right? You cannot outguess every word that the question setter asks. You cannot outguess every root word that the question setter asks. So you can devote that time to answering the RCs smart, the smart way to answer RCs. Important announcement for you. CAT 21 is happening on November 29th, and what are we going to do? We are going to bring for you the D-Day activities, November 28th, not November 29th, Sunday, November 28th. Monday is 29th when a big weight will be off my head. So don't forget to be there. If you are in the first slot, then immediately after the exam, log in to our website, log in to our app, log in to our YouTube channel, right? Whichever is the most convenient for you. And make sure you watch our analysis. Slot 1 analysis, Srinivas Akkapedi, LRDI expert, also very good. He's good at analysis. He's good at RC also, but he will not be going into RC so much. RC difficult questions, Kabir, for IIFT, you don't have to do. For IIFT, you just leave it and move to the next one because timing is important. And IIFT, you don't get difficult RC questions. You get easy ones and you get inference ones. The difficulty is only in terms of the time it will take for you to find the answer. Okay, if you see the last 3 years' papers and if you look at our mocks which are patterned on the last 3-4 years' papers, you will know that. Alright, so slot 1 analysis, Srinivas Akkapedi, slot 2, Gautam Bawa and Saral Nashir, and slot 3, Vikas and Pranav. Join one slot or all the slots. Okay, I would be there after the second session for the third session. Enroll in our CAT 21 is too late. Enroll in our CAT 2022 batches. Also, there is an exclusive batch for SNAP, NMAT, XAT and all. If you are taking those tests, make sure you analyze it. The key to answering hard questions, Kabir, is to read the passage properly. Attend the sessions that we have on YouTube, on our app and our paid sessions so that you get the correct, know the right approach to answering the RC questions. Okay. Very proud to be part of this team of experts who will be guiding you through who have guided you through CAT 2021 and will be guiding you through CAT 2022. Vikas, Pranav, Saral, Nikita, Sanujam, Gaurav, and of course Pradeep is also there. Pradeep's face is, picture is missing in this slide. All right. So if you like this session, do press the like. Sanujam has taken a series on YouTube and on the app on vocabulary for IIFT and other exams. Make sure you attend those sessions. They are there on our YouTube channel. Please attend those so that you do well in IIFT. In the meantime, do very well in the CAT exam. I shall see you during the analysis, helping our main experts do it. And all the best for that. Join us in our analysis immediately after the exam on November 28th. This is Savitri Krishnamurthy signing off for BYJU'S exam prep. Stay focused and stay cheerful. Bye-bye.